When people think about the word Ming, they often think about Ming vase, Ming porcelain. And certainly when people come into this exhibition, they will see some of the most beautiful porcelain that's ever been made. But I hope also they'll be surprised to see Ming objects of a kind that they had not anticipated or not expected. Most of the things in the exhibition have never been seen in Britain before. A great number of things excavated in China very recently. The Ming period in China lasts from 1368 to 1644, but in this exhibition we're concentrating on a narrower period, the half century from 1400 to 1450. It's a period of unprecedented engagement by the Ming Empire with the rest of the world. In some ways, the textbook understanding of the Ming has been one in which the Ming was the absolutely quintessential Oriental despotism, in which you had one imperial court that called all the shots. And one of the things that new research has done is shown us the importance of, especially at this early period, the regional princely courts, which are spread across China. So one of the big themes of the exhibition is the role of these regional princely courts.
The exhibition itself is divided into five rooms. So the first is all about the imperial courts, but also the regional courts that were set up by the Ming founder. Within that section, you have the most extraordinary quality of objects. Many of these things have never left China before, and they are truly stunning. So you have solid gold ewers, 3 meter high golden embroidered textiles, costumes of a prince who died of a drug overdose at the age of 19, and the only extant crown of a prince covered in jewels.
One of the crowns that we have is a 9-tasseled crown with beads hanging in front of the face of the wearer. And the emperor would have had 12 threads, whereas the prince has 9 threads of these gems. So that actually shows very clearly that these princes were cultural representatives of the emperor in these other parts of China. They're the only surviving examples that we have of those particular crowns from China so far.
Within the Arts of War section, we have a 7-meter long scroll which shows eunuchs in the Forbidden City Gardens playing keepy-uppy, playing mini-golf, shooting arrows and riding on horses to play polo. And there's also a whole range of inlaid weaponry of fabulous swords, saddles, helmets, guns and cannon. We move into the section about the arts of peace, and here some of the finest paintings from the early 15th century are displayed. But also in this section devoted to culture, we have perhaps what's been described many times as the world's first encyclopedia. In fact, it's a compilation of all knowledge, rather like a very early Wikipedia, in which all types of different kinds of knowledge are brought together, everything from feng shui diagrams to recipes for beans. In the section on beliefs, we get across the idea of multiple faiths coexisting peacefully within China.
One of the things that we're very thrilled to have in the exhibition is a Quran written in Beijing. And this Quran, which was written by a Chinese Muslim calligrapher, is dated 1401. It's the earliest dated Quran that was produced in China. And it's a very important piece of material and visual evidence for both the multicultural society of Ming China and the fact that this was a society in which a number of religious traditions lived side by side and were all, to a degree, patronized by the imperial court.
The AHRC funding was generous and allowed us to achieve time which we could spend on the project. It allowed us to organise a fantastic forthcoming conference where we will have over 30 speakers from around the world discussing topics centred on the early 15th century and court culture. I've been to China about 3 times each year during the project, and this has allowed us to develop relationships with the 10 different museums that we're working with in China, and also to increase the profile of the project, which has certainly reached the ears of the very senior politicians within the Chinese government.
One of the most spectacular objects in the exhibition is this solid gold belt. The belt was made for Prince Zhuang of Liang, a younger brother of one of the early Ming emperors. The gemstones with which it studied were not produced within the Chinese empire itself. They almost certainly came from Sri Lanka, and therefore they demonstrate the ways in which the contact between the Ming Empire and the other parts of the world put into circulation types of object and types of material that they hadn't had access before. It's a very spectacular object, but it's also a very historically weighty object. And for me, what we've tried to do in this exhibition is bring together a body of objects that are both visually interesting and that people will be able to enjoy on that immediate level, but that if you delve into them and think about why are they here and what are they telling us, that they will also inform and stimulate on that deeper level as well.
The final exhibit is a Mantegna painting, a beautiful Renaissance painting showing the first representation of blue and white porcelain in Europe. And we want people to leave the exhibition with the idea that all of this exhibition occurs before the birth of Columbus, that China was truly internationally engaged well before the arrival of the Europeans in the 16th century. Every single detail of this exhibition has been researched. This will be visited by so many scholars from around the world. It really is a fantastic showcase of how a museum and a university can work together to deliver some original research with a great public outcome.